From the Song of Songs, whither is thy beloved gone? O thou fairest among women, whither is thy beloved turned aside, that we may seek him with thee? My beloved is gone down into his garden, to the beds of spices, to feed in the gardens and to gather lilies. I am my beloved, and my beloved is mine. Will you turn with me to our screen as we sing our opening hymn this morning, Faith is a Victory. Please bow with me. Dear most gracious and holy Father, how wonderful it is to be able to call you our Father. In all the world, even man cannot create or imagine a God such as you, one who loves his children above all, one who has created us in the world we live in with such magnificence, one who sees his children suffer in their bondage to sin and sacrifices his only Son to give us freedom from that bondage. One who is able to overcome all obstacles, yet says that obstacles are mere nothingness to overcome. Small minds have created small gods who always hold their followers as captives and servants. In the name of such gods, men engage in such butchery as we have seen in the Middle East these past weeks. They have no love for their God, and their God is incapable of giving love to anyone because all gods created by men are empty vessels and deaf and dumb idols, nothing more. They will be swept away by your slightest command. Your love is real and it will stand eternal. One day you will claim all that is yours, and those men will stand as the prophets of Baal stood before Elijah, wailing and gnashing their teeth and hacking themselves, for they will receive no answer or protection. Judges who hold power today and defile your holy world will also stand before you and tremble. You are our beloved, and we are your beloved, and our beloved is you. Hold us always close to you, for it is in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. You may sit down and turn with me to our screen as we continue with our responsive reading this morning from Psalms 2, 10 through 12. Please follow with me. Be wise now, therefore, O ye kings. Be instructed, ye judges of the earth.
Serve the Lord with fear and rejoice with trembling.
Kiss the Son, lest he be angry and ye perish from the way, when his wrath is kindled but a little. Amen. That's the reading of God's Word. Our praise hymn this morning is Freely, Freely. Our memory verse this morning is from 1 John 1:9. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. 1 John 1:9. Will you please do your part?
If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. 1 John 1:9.
Amen. Well, I want to welcome everyone here this morning. Good to see all of you here, and it's good to see you at home as you prepare your evening and the time to spend with us. We're thankful that you're taking this time to be with us in our sanctuary as we invite you in and you invite us into your homes. We want to make sure that you know how to be able to get in touch with us out here. So you can get in touch with me by telephone or by several different ways. You can write Community Bible Church or to Reverend Babcock at P.O. Box 41, Titusville 16354. Or you can call Sarah at the bottom number, 827-3275. Or I'll find it here. Or you can call us here at the church at 814-967-3628. And if you want to look through the week, I think that we've had a little bit of difficulty getting on the internet this past month, but we'll get those back up and running right away. But if you want to look for us through the week, you can find us at www.oilregionlive.com. And we both want to thank Armstrong Cable and the stream for making our presence here available to you. And we want to thank you for taking the time to watch and be part of the program. I would love very much if you would write me, let me know what you think of what you see. I know we hear from people that tell us, people are watching, but you know, it's means much more when I hear something personally from one of you. And I hope that you'll take the time just to drop me a note. You can also get in touch with me if you're on the internet, and you can go to Yahoo at cbc.tville@yahoo.com. cbc.tville@yahoo.com for those of you who have internet service. We're still doing the breakfast thing. The breakfast program is really great. And so if you're, you know, some of you I know go to other churches and that are watching us in the evening and or on Wednesday, and if you're on your passing by here, we're still doing breakfast. Everyone's invited to breakfast. It's one of those things you can drop in and have a donut and a coffee and buzz on to your church or whatever. But we'd love to see you in here. I think we're the only place around that's open on Sunday morning that serves breakfast, right? in a lot of areas. So we've done that because we bring in kids that need to eat breakfast on Sunday morning, and everybody's trying to work hard, round up people, and do driving. And so we got people coming from Cambridge Springs and Meadville and Conneaut, and we come down from Conneaut. So it's nice to have that time to, in the morning before we start Sunday school. Sunday school's at 10, church is at 11, and our Bible study's at 6 o'clock on Wednesday night, and hope that you will want to join us for a Wednesday night Bible study. We really get into a lot of stuff, and it's an open Bible study. You can come in at any time and not miss anything. September 7th, we're still looking to go to a little north of Edinburgh on Highway 99 to a place there to play putt-putt golf, and we're going to have a cold lunch. So we're looking for a good group because we're planning on taking the bus. We want to fill the bus up and all the vans and take a good group with us. So September 7th, if you have that over. And last week we were going to have a movie night, Wednesday night, but it rained and rained and rained. Boy, we had a flood here, and I can't imagine. I mean, if somebody would have told me at the beginning of the summer, and I know I remember saying that in my prayers I was told it was going to be a wet season, I did not believe it was going to be this wet. And I didn't believe that it was going to be wet all through the summer. You know, and then here comes, we're getting close to September, and I don't know if it's going to ever rain up, stop raining. I've got to get the roof finished, and it's a lot. So pray for us this week as we try to get finished getting the roof done, and we're getting close to finishing up the fellowship hall. We just have a very, very little, a few little things to do to it, and those things are numbering down. Do I have any other announcements? Any other dates? When our next puppet ministry is the 13th. So the 7th will be when we're taking the kids directly from, and then the next Saturday, the 13th of September, we'll be having a puppet our puppet program here from 11 to 2. And we have a lot of fun with the kids when they come here. Anything else they need to? And our potluck for September will be on the 21st. All right, good. Anyone else? All right. And I still would like to, as my usher gets ready to come forward to make sure that you know that on Wednesday nights when it's nice, we light a bonfire, we cook s'mores and hot dogs, and we have a movie standing by the movie screen and a projector. They're ready to go. They like to be used. So we have a lot of fun when we do that. So look to come out and join us. If you can't come for Bible study at 6, be here for 7. And if you can't be here for 7, be here by the time it gets dark. And if you want to see, because we've had a couple of good movies that aren't going around, and that's what we're looking for, movies that aren't really going around that people would like to see. We saw God Is Not Dead, and that was a really good movie. And then we saw, what was the one that we did the week before? Heaven Is For Real. And so some of these movies that people really like, and so we've got some more movies like that that we'll be playing during the week. And we're still looking for donations for anybody that wants to contribute to the programs out here. Will my usher please come forward for tithes and offering? Will you please rise? Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. Dear most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for all the many things that you have done for us, and all the gifts and all the blessings. And we ask you to bless this offering. Bless the gift of time and energy from each person. Bless each and every one. Help us to grow here, to spread the gospel, to reach people, to reach the lost, to one day be that place where after the rapture is completely empty and nothing and no one will be here, because we'll all be with you. Bless this offering. Help us to be good stewards of all that you give us. In Jesus' name and for his sake we pray. Amen. Any praise and prayer requests this morning? God working wonders and miracles in your life? Yes.
I'm going to pray for my cousin and her husband's life was spared when they were in a head-on collision and their car was totally
gone. Yes, you were telling us about that on Wednesday night. And so that's your cousin, right? Somebody that was drunk came across and just hit him head on. They couldn't even do anything about it. Just came over, hit him head on. Fortunately, they survived that. So praise God for that. I mean, what do you do in that kind of situation when somebody just comes across and hits you, like the deer jumping out front of a motorcycle? It's hard to. You just have to pray to be. We have to pray to be in God's grace all the time, I think. Maybe we should take a note from the people that talk about paying it forward. Maybe we should be praying ahead. We should be in God's grace. So a lot of times God brings us to a point where we wind up with a good scare to bring us back. But yes. So, anyone else this morning? Yes.
I want to thank God that my car was not as bad as what I thought it was going to be when I had to in the shop again.
with the grumbling and the and that then. And it was at a time where you had a very critical meeting that you had to be at, and
thank God that that went very well.
And so, you know, Satan just does. He just throws these things out so that you can't be or do those things that you're supposed to do. Yes, anyone else this morning have a praise? Hey, school's coming. Going to start Tuesday. Oh, is that a praise? Are you excited for school to start? Yeah. So school's starting, and then we've got a lot of praise about that too, because we have several people that are involved in school as well. So, any other praises this morning? How about prayer requests? Teddy, yeah. I got a call that Teddy had to go back to Pittsburgh on an emergency status for a transfusion. So we want to keep, Dee Dee gave me a call about her mom, and we want to keep Dee Dee's family. Anyone else this morning? Jean? Okay. Dan? Anyone else? All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for all the stuff that you do for us that we don't even know. All the times that you're there to take care of us. All the times that your hand moves things out of the way and protects us. We want to thank you for taking care of Linda's cousin. We ask you to. And we thank you for watching over Jane in her car, that she could make her appointment and still get her car fixed and it wasn't a total disaster. Lord, it's sad when we get emergency telephone calls that someone is on their way back to the hospital, but we ask you to keep your hand upon Teddy. We know that you have been answering our prayers and you will continue to keep your hand upon Teddy. We ask you to be with Dee Dee and her family and her mom and all the stuff that's going on there with Bob and all that. We ask you to put your hand upon Gene as he's ill again, and just keep your hand upon him. We ask you to watch over Dan as he continues to struggle with his alcoholism and other issues. We ask you to be with all of our unsaved loved ones. We thank you that some of our children have wound up to be in a more stable situation than they were a couple weeks ago. And we ask you to continue to keep your presence known there and watch over those kids. And Lord, we ask you to be with all of those that are not here today, that had another reason to not be here. We ask you to be with this country as we continue to struggle with the direction. For us, it's a clear choice, a clear path, the direction that we want. But for many, the path is not clear and it's cluttered with all kinds of things. Lord, we pray for the situation over in the Middle East. We pray for the Christians and the Jews and the innocent people that are being slaughtered in the name of Allah, a fake and false god. I ask you to keep your hand upon our young men and women serving this country, that you will watch over them and their families, and help them to serve this country with honor and distinction, to allow us to continue to be the free Christian nation we have always been. Help us to be all that we can be. Be with this church and help us to grow, and help us to be the beacon that we need to be in this community, to reach out to those who are lost and sick and poor and needy and struggling. Help us to be all that we can be, all that you need us to be. In Jesus' name and for his sake we pray. Amen. Our hymn, Create in Me a Clean Heart.
Create in me a clean heart, O Lord, my God. And renew a right spirit within me.
We're in the book of Hosea, chapter 2, verses 1 through 13. And I think it's quite appropriate that the song, Create in Me a Clean Heart, as God struggles here, this book has always, always amazed me so. That God could agonize over us this way and this much. And that's what this book is about. Creating in us a clean heart. Say ye unto your brethren, Ami, and to your sisters, Rama. Plead with your mother, plead, for she is not my wife, neither am I her husband. Let her therefore put away her whoredoms out of her sight and her adulteries from between her breasts. Lest I strip her naked and set her as in the days that she was born, and make her as a wilderness, and set her like a dry land, and slay her with thirst. And I will not have mercy upon her children, for they be the children of whoredoms. For their mother hath played the harlot, she hath conceived them, hath done shamefully. For she said, I will go after my lovers, that gave me my bread and my water, my wool and my flax, my oil and my drink. Therefore, behold, I will hedge up the way with thorns and make a wall that she shall not find her paths. And she shall follow after her lovers, but she shall not overtake them. And she shall seek them, but she shall not find them. Then shall she say, I will go and return to my first husband, for then was it better with me than now. For she did not know that I gave her corn and wine and oil, and multiplied her silver and gold, which they prepared for Baal. Therefore will I return and take away my corn in the time thereof, and my wine in the season thereof, and will recover my wool and my flax given to cover her nakedness. And now will I discover her lewdness in the sight of her lovers, and none shall deliver her out of mine hand. I will also cause all her mirth to cease, her feast days, her new moons, her Sabbaths, and all her solemn feasts. And I will destroy her vines and her fig trees, whereof she hath said, these are my rewards that my lovers have given me. And I will make them a forest, and the beasts of the field shall eat them. And I will visit upon her the days of Balaam, wherein she burned incense to them. And she decked herself with her earrings and her jewels, and she went after her lovers and forgot me, saith the Lord. God desires love, not sacrifice. Gomer proves faithless. Israel proves faithless. God proves faithful. This chapter opens with the fifth very remarkable prophecy concerning the nation Israel. In the last two verses of the preceding chapter, we saw that Israel will experience a great increase in population. And in the nation, there will be a great turning to God. The northern and southern kingdom will reunite so that the 12 tribes will again form a single nation. I believe that happened in 1948. But here we have the prophecy 400 years before Jesus was born, or more than 400 years before Jesus was born, that it would happen again. They will appoint themselves one head who will be the Messiah. And Ami means my people, and Rama means pitied. So God is saying to the nation that the day is coming when he is going to say, you are my people. And verse 2, plead carries the thought of a great contention, because Israel, like Gomer, was unfaithful and went back to practicing prostitution. God is applying Gomer's sin to the nation. Hosea married a girl who had become a harlot, and even after they had been married for some time and had three children, she went back to prostitution again. And all the while, this man, Hosea, loved her. The greatest sin in all the world is not murder or theft or lying or possibly, under certain circumstances, adultery. But judging from what the Scripture teaches, the worst sin one can commit is to become unfaithful to one who loves you. Applying this to our own lives, what is the greatest sin a Christian can commit? Many people feel that it is murder or lying or even coveting. But the greatest sin is unfaithfulness to God, who has redeemed you and who loves you. There is no sin greater than that. God says, go to your mother and contend with her. Tell her to come back to me. Tell her to turn away from her idolatries, lest I strip her naked and set her as in the day that she was born, and make her as a wilderness and set her out like a dry land and slay her with thirst. The language that's going on here is not, though Hosea is writing it, is not a language between Hosea and Gomer. It's clearly the language is between God and Israel. If she does not repent, God will judge, and I will not have mercy. Just think about that for a moment. We live in an age where we hear preachers telling people that somehow God will not judge and God will find a way for everyone to go to heaven. Yet, God makes it quite clear here, he will have no mercy. The entire nation had turned to idolatry. As you read the scripture, and I was reading about them turning their gold into idols, that made me think about Moses being on top of the mountain. while he was up getting the Ten Commandments, while it was clear that he was there with God, the people down below were busy taking the gold that they thought was theirs and making a golden calf to Baal. I will go after my lovers that gave me my bread and my water, my wool and my flax, mine oil and my drink. Does that sound familiar? Does that sound like today? I took the parts out because it's my. Isn't that what's going on today? We live in this world where we're concerned about my stuff, my things, the things that I'm going to get. Gomer is doing this for money. There is money in prostitution. It is one of the big rackets in our day also. This may imply that Hosea was not a wealthy man and was not able to provide the luxuries which Gomer wanted. So she practiced harlotry on the side. Israel's sin was the same. She had turned to idols, which was spiritual adultery. The people of Israel were giving the idols credit for providing for them. Sometimes that, even today, makes me angry. When I hear people that have nothing to do with God, they don't go to church, they don't worship God, they don't do giving thanks to God for something. Does it make you angry? I can't imagine that God would the other one that is just as bad, and that is that to give credit to karma and to the universe for those things that God does provide for us. I will go after my lovers that gave me my bread and my water. Those are the necessities. My wool and my flax, mine oil and my drink, those are the luxuries. And all the while, it was her loving God who was providing all those things for her. The total and complete ingratitude of the human race, and especially professing Christians, for all that God has provided. Well, you may say, I am an intelligent, hard-working person. I provide for myself. I have news for you. God has provided all the material things for you. Anyone that comes to you and says, but I did this myself, I'm responsible for the stuff that I did it, is wrong. Because God has provided everything. He is the one who gave you intelligence. He is the one who gave you a measure of health and strength. He is the one who provided the job for you. In fact, He is the one who created this earth with a well-stocked pantry and with clean air and clean water and sunshine. How can one sin worse than giving credit to oneself for all God has provided? It is true that we live in a day when terrible crimes are being committed. Stealing, lying, murdering. But the worst sins are being committed by the children of God who are ungrateful. Therefore, behold, I will hedge up thy way with thorns and make a wall that she shall not find her paths. I believe that our problem with jobs and the economy right here today, right now, is that we have sent a clear and loud signal to God that we have everything by our own hand and that we can do just fine without God. Don't we send that signal? Isn't that the signal that goes out loudly? And so, I mean, here we have a military now sending combat troops out or just doing daily work without being able to pray in the name of Jesus Christ. So who do they give credit for the energy that they... Is it the government saying, well, we're the government, and so because we're the government and we pay the soldiers, we're responsible for what they did? We don't need God anymore, right? Isn't that where we go headed? Isn't that the conflict that's going on? And we can do all this by ourselves, and we don't need a God. And so just as, and it's the same thing that was going on at the time of Hosea. And so just as he did with the nation of Israel, he is backing away from this country. I mean, it's so simple for me to see the parallels between what happened in Israel and what is happening here. But all of a sudden, as we turn further and further away from God, we have less and less of a vibrant economy. We have more and more trouble. We have more and more unrest. I'm not sure that I have known a time where there has been less peace in the world than there is now. Even though I was in Vietnam, there wasn't as many places in battle as there is now. Communism was the big thing, but they weren't cutting the heads off of Christians, murdering children, going in and taking over an entire village and selling the women off to be wives, slaves, prostitutes. So you have thousands of Europeans and even Americans going over there because they'll go in and take over a village and you can buy a wife for $12. Did you know that? And we debate here as to what we're supposed to do about it. Sometimes I think that we just act as if we don't have a God. And it's just not important for us to be godly people. We put God last in our lives on most everything that we do, even coming to church and worshiping God. So many other things are more important. I mean, it's Sunday morning, and the reality is that every church in America should be on this Sunday, especially after the beheading this week, should be filled to the brim. There should be standing room only in every church. But there's not. We should be taking our time and thanking God for all the things that we have received this week, but we're not. Because we are so puffed up with ourselves that we think that we have everything by our own hand. We've accomplished a lot on this property over the last year. But I can proudly tell you that not a bit of it has been accomplished by our own strength. Not one penny has been put in the coffers by our own pride, because we haven't had the money. Somehow it's appeared. It's appeared because we've been faithful. The work has got done because we've been faithful. We were able to get 2,100 pounds of cement on the roof this week only by the grace of God. Only by the grace of God. It couldn't be done otherwise. But yet, where are all the people? God cries out in this book of how much he's done, how much he's cared, how much he's been there to be, and how the people have just have become prostitutes. Isn't that what we do when we give credit to somebody else for the what God has put in our hands? And I think that just as he did with the nation Israel, what happened to the nation Israel? Israel became, you know, Israel after Hosea, you know, grew up and became this mighty nation. It became the greatest power in the universe, right? Didn't it? I mean, they threw God out and they actually ascended to be, you know, the greatest empire the earth has ever known, right? Didn't they? Didn't they do that? I'm sure that some history books got it right that they did. What happened to them? They wound up being dispersed all over the world. They lost everything. Why does it take, is it so hard for people to understand that when you turn away from God, that's a sacrifice, that's the condition, that's what happens. Israel didn't become anything because God didn't allow them to become anything. Israel will become the greatest empire this planet has ever known when Jesus Christ is sitting on the throne in Jerusalem. And that is what boggles my mind. How we can ever put something else before God, before our the things that we're supposed to be doing for our Lord. How that we can live our life and put something else and expect that God is going to work in our life when we see over and over again. But I see a God that agonizes. I mean, the first time I read Hosea, it really brought me to my knees because I really, you know, I had a love affair with God, but I never knew a God that cried about me, that agonized over us. I mean, the book is full of this, you know, it goes back and forth, and if you want to just read it, it's Hosea doing the reading, but, you know, we're talking about these big words that don't have anything to do with Gomer, but the whole nation of Israel, you know, it's God. And what does God want? God wants us to turn back to Him. I mean, He agonizes. The language, I mean, as a marriage and family therapist, I see this kind of behavior from in broken families and people, you know, the jealousy, the anger. And then I see God, you know, looking and actually visualizing what's going to happen if he makes Israel naked. And then He recants. For she did not know that it was I who gave her her corn and wine and oil and multiplied her silver and gold which they prepared for Baal. We, in this country, are very prosperous. We have wonderful fields that can grow almost any crop. We've discovered oil that makes us have more oil than Saudi Arabia and other places, and they still haven't discovered all of the oil that's still in this continent, in North America. Matter of fact, we have so much natural gas that they're burning off, what is it, $100 million a day worth of it out in the Dakotas because they don't have any place for it. How do we get that? God says that it was by His hand. I gave her corn and wine and oil and multiplied her silver and gold. And it has to make you just cry to understand that all the things that God has given us, given them and given us, are prepared for Baal. I just find this hard to imagine. It blows my mind completely. And I don't understand Israel, after going through everything that Israel went through, that Israel doesn't know that it God gave them. But then on the other hand, as I say that, it blows my mind that we don't know that this nation was, this continent was saved for Christianity. It was saved for us. We wouldn't be here if it wasn't. I find it just unimaginable here and now for us to be moving away from biblical principles and biblical principles and biblical truths, ruling after ruling coming down and moving us further and further away from God. Not only that, but an attempt to distort the truth and the facts, to force those who still believe and hold fast to their convictions to suffer at the hands of some governmental agency. This week we were reading about some of the things going on right here in Pennsylvania. Businesses being forced out of businesses or being required to go to sensitivity classes because they don't want to violate their Christian principles. Sensitivity classes, what is that? We know that that is just is brainwashing, right? So we called it, when I was in the military, it was brainwashing. It's just another new, modern, politically correct, non-offensive name. But brainwashing is brainwashing. It doesn't matter if you were Russian and sent to the Siberian Gulag or Chinese and sent to a re-education camp. The sensitivity classes people are being ordered to go to here in the U.S. are the same thing. And you're going to see them getting bigger and bigger and more complex because they're just brainwashing. Re-education, sponsored and enforced and enhanced by our very own government. God says that He will judge Israel. I think we can apply the same thing to our own nation. We have too many judges and politicians who know a great deal about the law but know nothing about how God rules or overrules even the laws of a nation, especially when the laws are wrong and the wrong men sit in high places. And now, will I discover her lewdness in the sight of her lovers? And none shall deliver her out of mine hand. I don't understand how people can understand it. Here, don't understand it. There is no escape from God. I don't care who you are. There is no escape from God. You can be a high judge, make a ruling. You can be the president of this or in charge of that and make a ruling that affects other people. But you can't escape the judgment of God, no matter what you do. Why don't we understand that? No one shall be delivered out of my hand. I will also cause all her mirth to cease. Her feast days, her new moons, and her Sabbaths, and all her solemn feasts. You know, I don't think we're as happy today as we were a decade ago. Are we? People running around and as happy as they were a decade, 15 years ago? Things aren't getting better, are they? Gee, well, here it is. Here it is in Hosea. If you don't follow after me, I'm going to take away your feast days. And I will destroy her vines and her fig trees. Whereas she hath said, these are my rewards that my lovers have given me. I will make them a forest, and a beast of the field shall eat them. And I will visit upon her the day of Balaam, where she burned incense to them. And she decked herself with her earrings and her jewels, and she went after her lovers and forgot me. The greatest sin in all the world is to forget God. Believe me. The greatest sin in all the world is to forget God. I'm just, as I said again, I am just so deeply, deeply impressed by the emotions that are being expressed here in this book. But how do you think hate came into being? How do you think envy came in? Or how about jealousy? How do you think we obtain the emotion sadness? Or the agony that is being expressed here. Do you think God invented those just for humanity? I've watched a couple movies about artificial intelligence lately, and how much detail is going into creating artificial intelligence. We cannot figure out how to create a computer humor. We can create a laugh, but it is empty. It has no meaning apart from the feeling and understanding. I'm sure that many of us Trekkies that watch Spock and the other one, the android, always trying to be human, trying to understand a joke, couldn't. We're trying to create computers that can do that. Can love be created in a computer? Well, it cannot. Can emotion be created in a computer? Again, it cannot. The book of Hosea is full of these emotions, and they are not here because they belong to God. God gave those to you because they were first in Him. You love because God loved first, and because God is love and expresses love. But He has all those emotions. They are also in God. God created us in His image so that we see here is a real remarkable example of how God is feeling about how He is being treated by mankind. We will see this expressed over and over again and again throughout this book. It should give you a completely different perspective concerning God. Men, especially here in the Judeo-Christian world, who rose to power, especially here in the United States, made decisions based upon how that decision would please or displease God before today. How it would impact on God's creation. Now, I can prove that because you go back into history and you find all kinds of things, and I don't know why it kept impressing me. The Gettysburg Address. 67 years ago, our fathers brought forth on this continent a new nation, conceived, brought forth on this continent a new nation, conceived in liberty and dedicated in a proposition that all men are created equal. Now, we are engaged in a great civil war, testing whether that nation or any nation so conceived and so dedicated can long endure. We are met on a great battlefield of that war. We have come to dedicate a portion of that field as a final resting place for those who here gave their lives that that nation might live. It is altogether fitting and proper that we should do this. But in a larger sense, we cannot dedicate, we cannot consecrate, we cannot hallow this ground. The brave men, living and dead, who struggle here have consecrated it far above our poor power to add or detract. The world will little note or long remember what we say here, but it can never forget what they did here. It is for us, the living, rather, to be dedicated here to the unfinished work which they who fought here have thus so far nobly advanced. It is rather for us to be here dedicated to the great task remaining before us, that from these honored dead we take increased devotion to that cause for which they gave the last full measure of devotion. That we here highly resolve that these dead shall not have died in vain. That this nation under God shall have a new birth of freedom. And that government of the people, by the people, and for the people shall not perish from the earth. This nation was created to be under God. We have a duty to be our God's children. It seems to me that today the decisions that have and are being made do not consider that this nation was created and dedicated to be under God. If it were so, where are the battlefields and where are the outrage? When we separate ourselves from God, God seems to separate Himself from us. The outcome is always the same: death, destruction, poverty, disaster, plagues, joblessness, hopelessness. In God, there is victory, and only in God can there ever be a victory. As I said, it is a remarkable example of how God was feeling about how He is being treated then by the Israelites, and it is possibly now by the church, the bride of His very own Son. I read from the Song of Songs, chapter 6, 1 through 3. And at the end, it's such a touching point. I am my beloved's, and my beloved is mine. Can we say that about our God and our Lord? That we belong to Him. That He is our beloved. And we are His. Our hymn of dedication is in the garden.